With Anthony Ancampura.
Welcome to Banyan's Faith and Recovery Radio Show. I'm your host, Anthony Ancampura. The Faith and Recovery Radio Show focuses on advice and insight for those in addiction, family members, and those suffering with addiction or mental health issues. Powerful personal testimonies. We also have guests who are experts in their field. I'm also the director and chaplain at Banyan Treatment Center's Faith and Recovery Program, which is in Pompano Beach, Florida, and we have 9 locations nationally. Faith and Recovery is a faith-based drug and alcohol treatment program. It's non-denominational, Christ-centered. The program is designed to allow clients to establish or restore their faith and relationship with God while addressing their addiction. If you or someone you know is in need of substance abuse treatment, contact us at 888-270-5712, 888-270-5712. Or if you have questions or you want a question answered on one of our future shows, 201-538-2754, 201-538-2754. Okay, I want to get right to it. I want to introduce our guests. They're in studio here. They just made the trip down, and we're blessed to have them here. A couple of great guys, and they're doing some great things for the Lord. They really are doing some things for the kingdom here. Pastor Phil Dvorak is a leader in the field of addictions. He co-authored the 30-Day Recovery Guide with Dr. Paul Meier, founder of Meier Clinics, and Dr. Jerry Pingleton, who is the vice president of the American Association of Christian Counselors, great organization. He is a licensed mental health counselor and has been the pastor of the Recovery Church in Lake Worth for 7 years. We also have Pastor George Lynch. Pastor George grew up in a home of dysfunction where he learned to drink, drug, and commit crime from a very early age. His drug addiction led him to the Florida State prison system, where he finally surrendered his life to Christ. Amen. Upon getting released, George began to work in ministry, becoming a pastor of a homeless ministry, youth and recovery pastor, then going to work at a substance abuse treatment facility as part of a spiritual care team. He has been the pastor of the Vero Beach campus of Recovery Church for 9 months. Welcome, Pastor George, and welcome, Pastor Phil.
Thank you, Anthony.
Thank you.
So blessed to have you guys here. Thank you for coming down. And we were just talking a little bit about Recovery Church and what you guys are doing, and there's such a need, you know? I mean, obviously we know the need because of addiction and what's going on out there in the country. But to have something like this where you could have a place to go to and not feel intimidated and not feel that people are going to judge you and things like that, that is worth its weight in gold. I mean, that's huge. So it's great to have you. Pastor Phil, tell us about the 30-Day Recovery Guide that you co-authored, and thank you for these. You just brought a bunch of them here. Be Strong and Surrender, a 30-Day Recovery Guide. Tell us a little bit about that.
Awesome. Well, Dr. Meier is a founder of Christian counseling and just a leader. And he befriended me a few years ago and became a prayer partner.
Nice.
And he wanted to finish his 100th book, because he's written 98 books at that time, and wanted to finish his 100th book and said, "Will you write it with me?" And so I sent him a couple devotionals, and next thing I know, he was sending me half the book back. And so
Nice. We
wrote that together, and it's just supposed to be a supplement, a guide, a support for people early in their sobriety, early in their recovery journey.
That is great. That is, you know, the thing of it is with these types of things and these books and churches like this and stuff, you know, we don't, a lot of times people won't say it. They won't say, "Hey, you know, I need help," or I don't understand this," or, you know, and sometimes the resources aren't available or someone's intimidated to ask for the resources. So this is fabulous. Thank you so much. Pastor George, I read in your bio as far as you ended up in the, you know, the state prison, I guess, or Florida prisons. What was the breaking point while you were in prison that when you surrendered your will to God's will? Because it usually takes a lot of pain. I know it did with me to get to that point. So I'm just curious about, what was there something that happened, or how'd you end up getting there?
Yeah, for me, you know, I got saved at 13 years old, and my life went tragically downhill from there. You know, I knew Jesus as my Savior. I got my get out of hell free card, so you can say. Yeah. But at age 23, I found myself in the county jail on my way to prison, and I just knew that something had to change. I didn't want to live this way the rest of my life. I had friends that were going in and out of prison, and it was kind of like a trademark on the street. You know, you earned your stripes. You know, yeah. You became a gangster. Sure. You know, and growing up, that's what I wanted until I got there. Mm-hmm. When I got there, I wanted nothing to do with it, and so I just said, Lord, I need you to change me because I can't change myself. And I found myself on the floor of a jail cell, and I surrendered my life to Christ. I knew Christ as Lord then, mm-hmm. you know, not just Savior, but I knew him as Lord. I began to know him as Lord. And when I got to prison, you know, I did everything humanly possible to get to know him as Lord. As a matter of fact, I had a 60-year-old convict tell me about 6 months into my stay, he said, George, nobody leaves prison the same person they were when they came in. He said, most leave worse, but some leave better. Hmm. He said, you make sure you be a part of that sum.
That's interesting.
And I've never forgotten that. So, you know, I went and I fellowshiped with guys who were trying to better their lives. I fellowshiped with guys who I saw on the yard that were opening their Bibles, you know, right. and not participating with chain gang games, you know. And I did everything that I could to grow closer to God, because I knew that I couldn't change me. You know, I tried, you know, detoxes. I never made it to rehab because I couldn't make it past detox.
Right.
I'd get out of detox and I'd go right back to using. So I knew that if I was going to make it out of the gates of prison, it was going to take Jesus and Jesus
alone.
Absolutely.
Amen. Amen. Thank you for that. That's awesome. Just out of curiosity, like, what was the ratio of people? I know you hear these prison conversions and jailhouse conversions. What was there a lot of people in there in the Word? And you know,
there was, you know, you get a lot of antagonism, you know, a lot of, you know,
sure.
jailhouse religion, you know, you're just doing this to get out of trouble,
right.
you know. I found that there was a handful of authentic people seeking Christ, and that's who I gravitated towards.
Yeah.
You know, I gravitated towards those who I could see were truly emanating Jesus Christ in everything, in speech, in act, in everything that they were doing, not just in lip service,
yes.
not just because it was going to help their court case, not just because it was going to earn them some brownie points or something.
Right.
You know, I saw that they wanted life change, and that's who I gravitated
towards.
That's
great advice for our listeners out there, because a lot of times it's families that are, you know, listening, and their kids are struggling with their addiction, or they're just getting in trouble or whatever. I say it all the time. My father used to say, he's telling me, I never listened when I was younger, but tell me who your friends are and I'll tell you who you are,
mm-hmm.
right? And it says in Corinthians, bad company corrupts good character. So that doesn't just apply, that was in prison, mm-hmm. but it could be in a treatment center, it could be in a psychiatric, it could be in at home, at your job. Who are you surrounding yourself with? So that's great. Thanks. That's a good. That's good advice. Let's go back to Pastor Phil here, and let's talk a little bit about Recovery Church. Tell us how the Recovery Church came into existence. How did this whole thing start, and where is it at now?
Absolutely. So, a number of years ago, I was working in the treatment field. Probably a similar position as what you have, and my boss came to me and was not a believer, but said that we were looking at the stats, and everyone in the facility, we were participating in the Christian program, in the faith program, on all measurables were doing better.
Right.
And they were longer lengths of stay, more success at completing, less behavioral issues, less relapses, and everything that we could measure was doing better. So from a business perspective, he said, we need to get behind this. And he goes, I think whatever's out there is saying we need to start a church. And I said, no, I'm not going to do this right now. But he kept coming after me saying, I really think that we need to start a church. And so I brought my pastor who down and met with him and said, if you two can figure out how to do this, I'll get behind it. And this conservative Southern Baptist pastor and this person who believed that there were things out there but not sure what it is came together and said, no, we're going to do this.
Wow.
And got behind me and supported. And we have been running Recovery Church now for a number of years, and it's all been voluntary. Everyone's a volunteer. We have a campus now in Vero Beach. We have a campus in New Jersey. We have a campus, another 12-step meeting in Lantana and Lake Worth, and we're seeing people in Missouri and New York.
Wow.
And have a training coming together where we're going to have many more campuses. And so it started by God.
That's amazing. Aren't always the best ideas and the best things that they come from him. It makes me think of Proverbs 3:5. It says, trust in the Lord with all your heart. Lean not in your own understanding. We're not going to understand his ways. Is there higher than our ways? Thoughts are higher. And then when we just trust and we're like, you know what? I'm going to surrender. I'm going to do it. It's like, man, I wish I did this before. I wish I did it longer, earlier. We're going to need to take a quick break. We'll be back in 30 seconds. Spaniards Faith and Recovery Radio Show. I'm Anthony Akinpora. We're here with Pastor Phil and Pastor George from Recovery Church. We'll be right back.
Are you struggling with addiction or mental health disorders? Banyan Treatment Center's Faith and Recovery Program helps people at the depths of their despair, spreading the word that recovery is possible through the power of Christ.
Cry out to him. Where are you, God? Where are you? I don't feel you. Where's your presence? Why are you allowing this to happen? He already knows our thoughts anyway. We might as well just put it out there.
Program Director Anthony Ankampura will help you discover how God can turn your mess into your message. Call Banyan Treatment Center for help now. 888-230-3122. Again, that's 888-230-3122.
Welcome back to Banyan's Faith and Recovery Radio Show. I'm your host, Anthony Akinpora. We're here with Pastor Phil and Pastor George from Recovery Church. We're talking about how that whole thing got started and how God had his hands on that from the beginning. And it's just, we were talking about Proverbs 3:5, trust in the Lord with all your heart, lean not on your own understanding, right? So we're not going to always understand everything of God. We just need to trust, right? He has our best interests at heart. So let's get back to this. I want to go back to Pastor George here. We were talking a little bit about how you came to Christ and things like that. Why do you think it takes so much pain for people, and myself included, because I'm one of them, that they took a lot of pain. Why do you think it takes so much pain and suffering for us to finally put our hands up and say, I'm done. God, I need you. Lord, I need you. You know, what do you think that is? Why are we so resistant sometimes?
You know, I've been asked this question by, you know, many family members and people who have sought help for others. And I really wish I had a great answer to this question other than, you know, I was a hard-headed addict. You know, I wanted to do things my way. Mm. I can look back now and I can see all of the areas where God would offer me a way out. You know, people would say things to me like, oh, well, you know, look at what God's doing. You know, God chose this path for you. I don't believe that God allowed me to be an addict so I could help people today. You know, that wasn't God's plan for my life ever. Mm. You know, God used what the enemy meant for harm for good today. Yeah. You know, definitely. You know, I was an addict because I chose, and then the disease took over, and then, you know, it was just a snowball effect. You know, and I was hard-headed, you know, and I liked chaos, and I liked what it bred, and I lived in it, and I learned it. It was a learned behavior. I lived in a house full of dysfunction. You know, I grew up in it, and so, you know, other than that, I don't have a grand cookie-cutter answer for any of that other than, you know, the only way we can unlearn that is to learn Christ, you know, to learn Christ, you know, and to learn him and to learn the way out, you know, is the answer.
Absolutely. You know? Absolutely. It's so true. It's so true. You know, I want to go back to Pastor Phil here. talked a little bit about the Recovery Church and things like that. What's on the horizon for the Recovery Church? What's your vision? Where would you like to see it in 5 years from now?
Well, our vision is that we see a Recovery Church in every city across this country and beyond. We see a gap. We're not the answer, we're not the solution, but we see a gap in the process of recovery, especially for people finding faith. And so Recovery Church has become a nice bridge between the faith community and the 12-step fellowships and treatment centers, and from the treatment centers and 12-step fellowships to the faith community, right, where people who are far from God can still show up exactly how they are and smoking their cigarettes and tattooed up, not feel any guilt or shame, and show up and connect with Jesus and remove all those barriers that sometimes are there unintentionally or not even there. They can be great communities of faith, but when an addict pulls up and there's no ashtray and they're told to smoke behind the building, or there can be barriers to them approaching Jesus, and we try to eliminate those, allow them to connect with Christ, allow them to grow with Christ, allow them to grow in their recovery. And so we have a large vision.
Absolutely. Absolutely. The reality is it could be intimidating going into a church. You know, it really shouldn't be. You know, it should be the opposite of that. But there's some out there that are very judgmental. And you know, our clients, they'll pick up on it in a second. We go to Calvary Chapel in Fort Lauderdale. We have a great partnership with them. And I've never once heard anything even close to, they're judgmental, or we couldn't do this, or they were looking down on us. I have heard it at some other things. I won't say where, but it does happen. So they pick up on that, and they sense that, and that will make them shut down quicker than anything, you know, when you start with that judgment.
And it can be a person's mentality also. If they've been judged other places, they can walk into a place and just automatically feel judged. The people there won't be judging them. They can just feel like I'm being judged automatically.
Absolutely. Do you, Pastor George, do you feel the stigma of addiction is lessening at all? You feel, is there any movement on this?
I believe there's a great movement happening, and it's in the non-anonymous movement that I see happening all over, especially social media and the internet, as people become non-anonymous. For example, you know, I will protect other people's anonymity until the day I die. My anonymity is completely gone. I do not protect my anonymity. Everybody knows that I'm an addict. Everybody knows that I'm an alcoholic. Everybody knows my past. And I believe that breaks the stigma because I believe in my weakness, Christ is strong.
Amen.
You know?
Yes.
I believe the more that we do that, the more the stigma breaks. You know, the more it's seen that it's not a weakness, that it can be overcome, that it can be used as a strength, the more the stigma breaks.
Absolutely. Yeah, it's true. In our weakness, he is our strength. And all of the tests that we've gone through in life become our testimony.
Yep.
You know, at the 12-step meetings, it's not like they bring in, you know, professional motivational speakers. It's just people in the program sharing their testimony.
Absolutely.
And what are the ones that really blow you away are the ones that overcame a lot and had a lot of tests, and now they're sharing their testimony. And, you know, God, one of the reasons he'll allow suffering is for us to go through something, overcome it, have victory over it, and then help people, right, that are suffering with things similar to what we did, you know, and it's encouraging to them, and they see, wow, this guy, this was going on with you 5 years ago, and you were doing this, and now you're doing that. Hey, there's hope for me. That's the theme of the whole Bible, you know. I mean, the people that were used, Paul killing Christians, you know, it's just, it's amazing. Matthew, the tax collector, you know, a thief. So that's the whole theme, and that's really what the theme and the thread should be, and the message should be at the church. Right?
I was just reading a scripture a day or two ago. It says that, I think he was talking to Peter, it says, when you were sifted, then you will be able to lift your brother up. Not if you are sifted, but when you are sifted, then you will be able to lift your brother up.
Absolutely, absolutely. Pastor Phil, what do you think it is we're talking about? I mean, obviously the judgment, intimidation factor. What else do you think contributes to people being drawn to Recovery Church? Because for it to go from what you had to already the amount that you have and growing, mm-hmm. there's something going on there. Mm-hmm. And whatever it is, even if it's not in the Recovery Church, whatever's going on and whatever message you have and approach and philosophy that you have, that needs to be, you know, replicated in treatment centers.
Absolutely.
And things, because it's working.
Yeah, first I have to give credit to God. His spirit is moving. There's no question that when you come to one of our fellowships that he is present.
Yes.
And with that is a place of grace. And there are things that, there are processes we put in place, but at the same time, we have people who have come through a community who are now, every month we have them sharing their stories of faith, their stories of recovery. It's volunteer-led. They're a part of it. There are a lot of similarities to what you would see in a 12-step fellowship, where we have the open shares and we have, instead of handing out chips, we hand out crosses of different colors to symbolize our surrender. And there's systems that we put in place that are easily reproducible and not complex. Mm-hmm. And so I think that is helping with reproduction because we don't overcomplicate things. We have a few majors that we focus on, and on the minors, we're going to have grace, but where there's unity, we're going to have unity.
Beautiful. Yeah, because the reality is sometimes we major in minor things.
Absolutely.
So you have it the right way. Well, the major thing and the number one thing should be Christ. And
absolutely.
That's the focus. And if every... Yeah, we may disagree with this and that, and there's all these different denominations, but as long as that's the focus, we're in good
shape. We're not worried about the color of the carpet or if we're meeting in a church building or if we're meeting in a coffee shop. We're worried about that. We're drawing people towards Christ and drawing them towards recovery.
That's awesome. Thank you so much for that. Tell us how people could connect with you or follow you and what you guys are doing. Because I think this is really awesome, and I want to get this out mm-hmm. there so people could follow you on whether it's Facebook mm-hmm. or whatever social media platforms.
Yeah, we have all the social media platforms. Recovery Church FL, I believe, is our Lake Worth campus in Florida on Facebook. Mm-hmm. But if you go to recovery.church is our website. And there's more information there that's getting updated. You can also reach us on the phone at 561-313-0901. And we're just continuing to pray for that God provides the provision for what we need to continue to expand.
Absolutely. Sounds good. Pastor Phil, I want to ask you this. What advice or encouragement? There's people listening out there right now. A lot of times it's family members or loved ones or their best friend is in active addiction and, you know, or they're dealing with major depression and you get to the point where you become hopeless. What advice, what encouragement can you offer someone right now that's out there that's struggling?
The first thing I always like to say is you're not alone. If you watch the news, you watch the media, we understand we're in a crisis in our land, and we are not alone. Whatever stigma out there allows us to isolate, you are not alone, and I'd encourage you to do whatever you take as fast as you can. Don't wait. Don't put it off. If you need to go to treatment today. Pick up the phone and call. Get into a recovery church. Get into a Celebrate Recovery. Get to an AA meeting, an NA meeting, but start the journey now.
Absolutely. And you got to take that leap of faith. The thing about it is, with myself and a lot of people, I was talking about the suffering, sometimes you have to go through a lot of pain to get to that point, you know? And if the prayers were answered the first year when I started going through active addiction and depression and all this stuff, I probably would still be going through it because I needed more pain. I had to go through that. So now I look back at it and it makes sense. You know, I needed all that time. And now I actually pull and use those experiences to try to encourage other people that there's hope, you know? And that's the beauty of it. And that's what God does. He works all things together for good to those who love and are called according to his purpose.
Amen.
Right? So it's not our purpose. So when we're saying the Lord's Prayer, we're saying the Our Father, thy kingdom come, thy will be done. And we're saying your will be done. But what do? Sometimes 10 minutes later, we're taking our will back. Well, we're praying about something for a week and it's not happening. I want it in my will. I want it now. Where are you, God? So that type of thing. But this, we're going to need to close soon. It was great having you guys on.
Thank you.
Really a blessing. Anything you'd like to add? Anything at all?
Well, we just want to thank you for allowing us to be here. And if anyone is interested in finding out more about Recovery Church, we'd love to hear from you. And we're just excited to see what God's going to do.
Absolutely. That is awesome. I'm gonna give some information out about our center. But if Pastor Phil, if you'd like to close this out after I do that, that would be great. Close this out in prayer.
Wonderful.
Awesome. So this is great. You guys are excellent. I really, really will be praying for what you're doing. If you or someone you know is in need of treatment, please take that leap of faith. Go online, faithandrecovery.com or banyantreatmentcenter.com, or you could call us at 888-270-5712. I'm Anthony Acampora. Join us every Saturday and Sunday at 1:30 on The Word, 94.9 FM and AM 950. That's in Orlando, or in the Atlanta area, 7 a.m. on Sunday or 9:30 a.m. on Saturday. That's on 970 a.m. Faith Talk Atlanta. Such a blessing to have these guys on. Psalm 147:3 heals the brokenhearted and he binds up their wounds. Pastor Phil is going to close us in prayer. Thank you all for joining us.
Dear Heavenly Father, Lord, I thank you. And Lord, I just ask right now that whoever is listening, Lord, you speak to their hearts. You move them to do the next faithful thing, to take the courage, the leap of faith, whatever that is, to get well, to live a full, abundant life, Lord. You break the strongholds. In Jesus' name,
amen. 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 Thank you, guys.
Thank you.
God bless you.